Good evening. I'm Ariana Cohen-Halberstam. I am the Artistic Director of Boston Jewish Film and the Boston Israeli Film Festival. Thank you for being with us here tonight. I want to thank our festival sponsors, our presenting sponsor, the Fine Family Foundation and CJP. And also want a big thank you to the IAC and to the Consulate of Israel to New England. Tomorrow is our closing day. It's hard to believe that we're already ending the festival. It feels like it just started, but please join us tomorrow at 12:30 p.m. for a conversation with Shai Avivi, the lead actor from Here We Are. I'm so pleased to be presenting Menachem Begin, Peace and War today. It's a film about a politician, but it also comes from a very personal place, and I'm sure this will be a fascinating conversation. Director Levi Zini is an award-winning documentary filmmaker who's been working in the documentary field for over 40 years. He's on the board of the Israeli Documentary Forum. He's a lecturer and has sat on juries and judges for many funds and festivals, and is the founder of art director of Doc.Films, a production house in Tel Aviv. Welcome, Levi.
Thank you.
Levi will be interviewed by Dr. Shayna Weiss, who is the Associate Director of the Schusterman Center for Israel Studies at Brandeis University, and has been with the festival in the past, so you might recognize her. Thank you, Shayna, for being here. In about 20-ish minutes, Shayna's gonna take questions from the audience. So if you have questions for Shayna and for Levi, please put them into the Q&A section on the bottom of the screen, and we will get to those. Thank you both for being here. I look forward to your conversation.
Thank you, Ariana. So, Levi, I wanted to start with just how you came to make this film, right? It's both the story of a huge political leader and also a personal story as well. So tell us about that.
Sorry, I lost you again. Will you ask it again, please?
Yes. I wanted to ask you how you came to make this film and what inspired you to do it.
Why
you made this film?
Oh, there's a lot of reasons. I'll start with a personal one, if you don't mind. Menachem Begin, my late father, was admired Menachem Begin. My father arrived to Israel from Morocco in 48, and it took him quite a few years to understand that he don't like Ben Gurion and his red party, Mapai, left party, and he fell in love with Begin. And I say fell in love because it was no doubt emotional, very emotional. And we had a lot of argument about it because I thought Begin is awful prime minister, awful politician, very right-wing and so on. So we had a lot of discussion. We discussed Begin a lot in my home. Second, I think it's for a storyteller is a great character. I mean, it's a guy that in his youth was attend or wanted himself to lead and to help his Jewish people. I mean, he quite succeeded. He was a leader in Beitar in Poland, and then he came to Israel, and he was head of underground. And then after the establishment of Israel, his dream, suddenly they sent him to the back seats. And during 30 years, he tried again and again and again to put his hands on the wheel, and he lost, he couldn't. And then suddenly it happened. And then it was a great success, a great opportunity to get success. He made a first peace treatment of Israel with Egypt. and it was on the top of the mountain, the top of the day. And then came the war, the Lebanon war, that he led Israel to there. He led, not Arik Sharon, he led Israel there. They both did it. And then comes the depression. And he passed away very, he stepped out of the stage very sick, very sad, let's say. And so for a storyteller, it's a great story. I mean, one that at least he conquered the top and then fell down. Second, because from the point of view of political point of view, and it's interesting. He was a right wing leader. By the way, after that, I made another in the same kind of film about Arik Sharon. Both of them came from the right, and both of them understood that Israel has a problem. I mean, in 67, yes, we came back to our the land of our fathers and the biblical land, and it's great. And here is the Holy Land. But there is a problem, a big one. On this Holy Land to us lives people, lives Palestinian, 2 million people. So how you solve the problem? How you keep this Holy Land, and what we are doing with the people on? So the Begin and Sharon, there are still right-wing leaders that try to solve this problem. Begin suggested self-rule, and it didn't succeed to do it, and for many reasons. And Sharon suggested separating. I mean, Palestinian over there, what we call today the two-country solution. And so from my point of view, to find out that two right leaders understand the problem and try to solve it, it's quite interesting, because today there are no leaders in Israel, no politicians that asking themselves how we solve this problem. That's why Begin was quite interesting. I hope you're interested watching the film. But I think he's a very, very interesting character. And my idea was to get into the point of decision making. Mm-hmm. I mean, I try to understand decision making, and to understand decision making, you need to understand, to know about. People come to a decision making with all what they are, their biography, their experiences, so on. So I try to understand his decision making, for in peace and in war. And I hope it was quite interesting for the audience.
It was. One of the highlights for me is I'm a historian, so I was amazed by all the archival footage that you found. Not just the big moments like peace with Egypt, right? But also these small sort of intimate daily moments in Begin's life. I'm curious, how did you find this footage? How did you incorporate it? And what role did it play in the making of the film?
This genre of filmmaking, you have people that are speaking about their experience. And again, I try to speak with people that was in the decision making, and then archive material. So you are put a lot of effort to get many as you can. I went through a lot of archives and I found out very interesting thing. In Israel, in Begin time, there was just one channel, the public channel. And I find, and then I went, for example, to watch an archive from Lebanon war, but the Israeli shoot, the camera, the Israeli news camera shot, what they show in the Israeli TV, and then you go to what towards the foreigner cameraman put shoot there, and there is a lot of difference. Mostly the people of Israel during the war didn't see what's happening in Beirut because they didn't let us. Mm-hmm. And it was important to me to look all around to find out material from Beirut, from others think to find out not just what the Israeli people, cameramen show, the shots that the Israeli cameramen shot, but to find out the material from all around. And it's quite a fascinating work.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So I want to talk about a couple of moments in the film itself that really struck me. And I wanted to just hear some of your thoughts about it. And one of it was that the film was mostly, but not entirely chronological, right? There are points where you deviate from the chronology of Begin's life. And there's almost flashbacks to his life in Europe, his life in the pre-state period. And I was wondering why you did this and what were you trying to convey with these flashbacks or however you want to call them?
Please, you was so, I'm hardly hear you. So can you just say it again very short if you can?
Yeah, the film is not entirely chronological by time. There are points where it breaks with time and goes back to earlier periods in Begin's life. So I wanted to ask you, what was the thought between that and why you made those choices?
Okay, I'll tell you what my idea was. Again, it was there is chronology, a narrative tell, and again, I said, I want to go to decision-making. And when you have come to find out what makes this decision, you need to understand his biography, his experience, and to understand decision making, you need background. So I went to a decision making, and then I tried to understand what the background that the person that took this decision brought him to come to this idea. So that's because of that, I jumped from the time that Begin was on the chair of the prime minister and his background to understand why he did what he did at his time as a prime minister. That's the idea of this storytelling of this film. I hope you understand all my jumps. I think it was the rationale, and most of the time, I think it's helped me to understand his decision making.
What do you think were the lessons he took, let's say, from the Holocaust and his childhood in Eastern Europe that he brought with him as a prime minister?
No doubt, he wrote about it. He said it again and again. He was a part of the destroying of his people, and he. I think when he came to, for him, independent state, Israeli, for the Jewish people, was so important. It was important to everybody. but he was inside it. He lost his family there. And it was almost a religious way of looking at it. You know, one of the problem, not problem, but he was very different from the other leaders in Israel, which was, all of them was from the diaspora, but they have tried to be Israeli. He never tried to be Israeli. He all the time kept being a Jew. And maybe that's what fascinated part of the people in Israel to vote for him. And that was another part that didn't vote for him, because he was, in a way, he was Jew. And in Israel, we wanted to be Israeli, part of us, not all of us. Part of us wanted to be in Israeli, what we call Tzabar and so on. But what I learned during making the film, that something amazing, I think Menachem Begin tried to all the time to find balance between conflict issues. Let's say from being a Jewish country and democratic country, Israel. So how you find the balance between those two very conflict, let's admit it, issues. And he was very democratic, very liberal in a way, and very conservative in a way. All the time he tried to find a way of balance between conflict issues. And I no doubt that he said it again and again, that his family was murdered during the Holocaust. He ran away, but it was very, very deep in his mind.
Thank you. Another moment that struck me was his relationship with Eliza, his wife.
Yeah.
And I was just curious, what was his relationship with Eliza like? How did it influence him, right? And when she died, right, what effect did that have on him, right, while also undergoing the crisis of the Lebanon War?
It's something, they went together, and he wrote about their meeting, the way they met each other, I mean, how he met her and so on. I didn't go into it. Again, I think she was part of his life. And as it used then, she went after him every place he went. He lived, I mean, when he was in jail in Sibir, in Russia, she waited for him, and even she arrived before him to Israel, and she waited for him. I mean, it was a kind of the women that are waiting for her partner, her husband. And there was, anyway, what people said there was very, very close, and she was looking after him all the time. And when she passed away, during the war, the Lebanon War, no doubt he felt that he lost some part of himself. But does this one brought him to his depression? It's a part of, but mostly he understood that he failed. In my opinion, Begin went to Lebanon War for the to save the West Bank, Judea and Samaria, as he called it. He went to Lebanon for that, not to conquer Lebanon. He wanted destroyed them, I don't have a better word in English at the moment, the Palestinian nationality, the PLO. He doesn't want him here because he wants to talk about the self-rule for the Palestinian with Jordan and Egypt. He doesn't want to, he didn't want to do it with the Palestinian leaders. So it was his goal in Lebanon part that they didn't want make a terror and bomb the north of Israel, but mostly he wanted to vanish them from the area. And then he came after, and then it, about one, about, almost 1 year after the war, he felt he understood that he failed. And while he feels that way, Eliza passed out. So it's I think it was together what make him step down from the political stage and put himself in a kind of and it's he went home and never and for 9 years he almost didn't show himself in the public life of Israel.
Right.
Just alone in his house.
Right. Bless you. So you mentioned that you come from a Mizrahi background, right? Your father emigrated from Morocco. And right. A lot of Begin's support came from the Mizrahi community, right? And that's an alliance that continues until this day to a large part. So I was wondering if you could comment on Begin's relationship with the Mizrahi Jewish community in Israel and why he is able to relate to them. You know, he is Ashkenazi, while other Israeli politicians could not.
Okay. Let's start with the emotion side of this thing. I think what one of the Israeli conflict or problem that here we didn't understand that there is a difference between being Zionist and being arriving to Israel by being Zionist and by coming to Israel by what I calling hearing for Zion. And most of the peoples that arrived from the Muslim country, what we call the Mizrahim, as most of them arrived to Israel not because they are Zionist. They came because they hearing for Zion, which means they have a relationship, a religious feeling to the country. Zionism is a national ideology that came from the West, part of the, what happened in Europe at the beginning of the 20th century. And the conflict between hearing of Zion, which the religious part of it, and Zionism makes the conflict in Israel. And then came Begin, and he was a Jew. He didn't want to cut out, as a Zionist, cut out all connection to the diaspora, all connection to what's happened before, and to raise here a new Israeli blonde and strong and so on. And he, that's, I think, what's put, that's why the Mizrahim find Begin a lot closer to them. He didn't want them to cut out their roots. He understood their religious sentiment, and that's what did it. And there is, this is from the emotional side. And if we go to the political side, the Likud was the first party in Israel that opened opportunities for the people from the Pardon?
So you can say it in Hebrew if you forgot the word
and all. Yes, from the periphery.
From the development towns.
to the people. I mean, it opened as a political corridors for them. They gave them the opportunity to be part of the Israeli politicals by saying what they called it the primaries in the. I mean, if you are from Dimona, whatever, any small town in the Negev, by what the primaries in the Likud gave you the opportunities to elect in your place and be part of the Knesset. I mean, to come to the Knesset. I mean, he opened for those people from the periphery. At the way he opens the door to the corridor of the Knesset. That's why a lot of them joined him, joined the Likud. And I think both of them, the emotional sentiment or the religious sentiment and the opportunities that he gave, made him a favorite of the Mizrahim. And there was a clash, cultural clash, religious clash, which is, we are still inside it in Israel.
Thank you. You know, the film focuses on these outside clashes, right? Foreign policy. And you alluded to some of these in domestic clashes. Religious, cultural. I was wondering why you didn't include those in the film. Would you want to, right? And what was your thinking about what went in and what went out of the film?
It started as a 3-episode series. The first episode dealt with the peace with Egypt. The second one I told about the internal issues. And in the third one, I went to Lebanon. Film went to Lebanon, not me. But when I came it was about 160 minutes. So mm-hmm. when I decided to make one film, my decision was that I'm going, I want to deal with what the outside political, because again, there was a peace and a war. It's very, 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 I mean, you look at it and you ask yourself, hey, this may make a peace, made a peace. And just two years after it, he took Israel to a bloody war in Lebanon. I mean, it's quite impressive that in 5 years of being prime minister, you did peace and a war. And so I think I would like to concentrate on this part in the one day. The feature length documentary. So most of the inside story was left in the series.
So I wanted to ask you, and this is, I'm combining and sort of looking at the questions that are coming in, to go back to the personal, right? What you made this film largely because of your father. What did you learn about him in the process, right? What in doing this film helped you understand your father better?
I said, if in my youth, I thought Begin is an awful person, and I couldn't understand what my father found in him. I found quite a very interesting thing in Begin politics way, but I don't think I can understand my father. I am a son of an immigrant. And to be son of an immigrant, it's quite, most of the time, as I understood it, and I made about those films as well, my father didn't want me to be like him. He wanted me to be part of the new country. I mean, not consciously, but that's what he did. And in a way, I would. It took me back to the question: am I a Jew or an Israeli? Do I have to decide that I'm first of all Jew and secondly Israeli? Is there a way to combine them together? That's a question that quite interests me, and the people of Israel are dealing with her. We should remember Israel is an immigrant country, and what's different from the state, which is also an immigrant country, that in Israel we are not speaking just of the future or the American dream, let's say, and we want to join to the roots of our people. I mean, we are trying to be in the past and in the future, which is very complicated. Let's admit it, it's very, very complicated. And I mean, it's helped me in a way to understand that, that conflict a bit better. Do I have an answer? No. I have this and this at the moment. I don't want to separate or to cut it and say all this, all this. I think I can merge them together.
So I'm gonna ask a question that historians hate, but I'm gonna ask it anyway. And that's about the Abraham Accords, right? In the past year, Israel has signed agreements with Dubai, Morocco, Bahrain. What would Begin think about this, right? Do we think he would be in favor? What would his reaction be to these agreements? And do we see echoes of his policies in these agreements?
May I add to this something?
Of course.
To make peace with Egypt, let's admit it, it's quite easy. It doesn't involve any religious emotion. It's okay, it's Sinai, it's great. We love to make peace with Egypt because nobody deal with our Judaism, with our holy land. We can make peace with Morocco, no problem. We'll do it with Abu Dhabi and Saudi and whatever. But what we're gonna do, how we are gonna make peace with the people that are living in our holy land? That's something that was very hard for the Israelis to do. Could they do it? I don't know. I really don't know. I hope. But the problem is to make peace, not with other country, there is no religious conflict inside. When we are coming to the political, to the Israeli-Palestinian conflict, it's not just a national conflict, it's a religious one. And when it comes to religious, it's gonna be a lot harder.
So related to that, I see a question that just came in that the Lubavitcher Rebbe was against the Camp David Accords, right? Especially because it involved uprooting, right, Jewish settlements. And he refused to be in touch with Begin after that. I was wondering if you could speak about that and Begin's relationship to the religious right, especially from the settler movement, which is part of the film as well.
Begin wanted to put Jewish people will set. He pushed the settlements. I mean, he wanted settlements in Judea. You know, till Begin, we called Judea and Samaria West Bank or the occupied territories. He was very insist that we call it Judea and Samaria. And in Israel today, they called it not West Bank. They call it Judea and Samaria. It was very important to him. I mean, but he understood the problem. That was important. He tried to figure out a solution for the problem between holy land for us and Arab people, Muslim people that are living on this holy land. He tried to solve this problem in his way. Most of the right wing at Israel at the moment don't see the problem. I mean, there is no problem as they see it. And it's great that he wanted to solve it. And again, lately, afterwards, Sharon wanted to solve it, and they didn't succeed it yet. And we are still in the same, I wouldn't say it, situation.
So I think we have time for one more question. And I wanted to ask you, I'm sure you've spoken to audiences in America and audiences in Israel and abroad. What are the differences in how they react to this film, right? And how they see your portrait of Menachem?
It's always a problem. The people that speaks to you, the creator of a project, mostly they love what you did. I mean, if they didn't love it, they are not coming to you. So as I understood, it was very interesting. And in a way, I did those films about Begin and about Sharon afterwards. For the young people in Israel, they don't know about our very, very close past. Very close past. Begin was about 40 years ago, let's say, and Sharon was about 20 years ago. And most of the youth in Israel just don't know nothing about them. And I think it's very important in that matter, in that way, that a lot of young people in Israel saw the film and saw the series when it broadcast, and it broadcast again and again and again on our public TV. I think it's very important that the people of Israel, the young one, they know their past. It's very important, and I hope I put, a little, ashpa'a, influence on it. Because it's for them, to my daughter, to her friends, mm-hmm. and so on. Yeah.
Well, thank you so much for joining us. I'm going to pass it back over to Ariana for closing remarks.
Thank you so much, Shayna, and thank you, Levi. This was a fascinating conversation, and thank you for bearing with us through, I know there were some technical difficulties. I also want to welcome everyone here from Palm Beach who ended up joining us for this conversation. I'm glad we were able to come together to have this discussion. And thank you for sharing your film with us, Levi, and for staying up late in Israel to be here with us tonight.
And I'm very, very sorry it's a confusion. It's very confusing.
As we say, tov tov kol tov, it worked out.
And we keep saying time is strange during this year, and I imagine many people have had many scheduling issues because of that. But I appreciate you sticking with us, and I appreciate everyone who joined us from Palm Beach. And thank you, Shayna. And thank you to everyone who's here with us tonight. I hope to see you tomorrow at 12:30 for our closing event, our conversation about Here We Are. And we hope to bring you here one day to Boston, and we can do this live. So thank you, and have a lovely
thank
night.
You.
Good night.
Thanks, everyone.
Bye. Good morning in my place.
Good morning. Good night. Bye.
Bye.